Good morning. Good morning. I'm Tom Werner, and I am a man under authority. I have asked my pastor, Tom Ricks, if he would be so kind as to read the scripture for us this morning and to pray for us. Tom, would you please?
Our scripture lesson this morning is taken from Luke's Gospel, chapter 4, verses 14.
Sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Then he rolled up the scroll, he gave it back to the attendant, and he sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he began by saying to them, "Today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him, and they were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. "Isn't this Joseph's son?" they asked. Jesus said to them, "Surely you will quote this proverb to me, 'Physician, heal yourself.' And you will tell me, 'Do here in your hometown what we have heard that you did in Capernaum.' Truly, I tell you," he continued, "no prophet is accepted in his hometown. I assure you that there were many widows in Israel in Elijah's time, when the sky was shut for 3.5 years and there was a severe famine throughout the land. Yet Elijah was not sent to any of them, but to a widow in Zarephath in the region of Sidon. And there were many in Israel with leprosy at the time of Elisha the prophet, and yet not one of them was cleansed, only Naaman the Syrian." All the people in the synagogue were furious when they heard this. They got up, drove him out of the town, and took him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built in order to throw him off the cliff. But he walked right through the crowd and went on his way. This is the reading of God's holy and perfect word. To him alone be glory. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for our brother in Christ, Tom Werner, your servant. We thank you for his leadership over this past year. And now, Lord, as he brings your word to us, we pray that you would fill him with your spirit. We pray that the time he has spent in prayer and in preparation would bear fruit in our hearts and in our minds. Father, we pray that you would give us spirit to hear, hearts to hear, minds to receive what the Spirit of God is saying to the church gathered here this morning. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
This is one of my favorite days of the year. I think this morning is the highlight of the General Assembly. Every year we have great messages. We will long remember Andrew and Noreen and their story and their vulnerability with us. Lance and the walkie-talkie and the security of our calling. Goonie Birds. And is it unihemispheric, whatever that stuff was. And Waiting for Wind, right? And the Commission of Outreach Workers. But there is something special about this morning as we worship together in singing. Thank you, worship team. We've had excellent teaching the times that I've been here. Mike Moses, Scott Griffin, Dean Weaver, men I look up to greatly. This morning we'll have the opportunity to receive communion and receive prayer. So there is something wonderful about being together this morning as God's family, and it's a great privilege for me to be able to contribute to the tradition of this service. I am officially an old guy. I walk down the streets of my town, Kirkwood, a small, delightful town, and occasionally I will glance in the windows of the shops, and I'll see an image there, and I'll look around to see who's that old guy. And I realize, oh, it's me. How did you get all that gray hair? Next year, it will be 50 years that I have been a believer, and you would think that I would be bored with my faith and perhaps with the scripture, but I assure you that I am not. I'm still learning, and I trust that the Lord will continue to instruct me until he calls me home. So let me tell you where we are going this morning. We're going to do a quick summary of the action of this passage. I'd like to tell you why this passage has historically, over these many years, been of significance to me. We're going to look at some of the mysteries of this passage, and then I trust that we can do some self-examination and some challenge. So at my home church, we start with frequently with what is called the sermon in a sentence. So here is the sermon in a sentence. Tom Ricks. Oh my goodness, how did that, you told us yesterday that you were sorry that got in there. I can't believe, the guy's been thinking about nothing but the Stanley Cup for weeks. Okay, the sermon in a sentence, please. The sermon in a sentence, Luke's remarkable story of Jesus in the synagogue of Nazareth calls us to revisit our faith and work for the kingdom of God as individuals, in our churches, and as a denomination. So let me pray for us briefly. Lord, we ask that you would be with us this morning. Instruct us, reveal to us who you are and what you've done for us, and help us to know how to respond, what to do in the light of your great grace. So, the summary of the action of this morning's passage is easily summarized. As our passage opens, Jesus has visited his hometown of Nazareth. He has started his ministry. He is becoming well known. And most important for our understanding of this passage, he is ministering in the power of the Holy Spirit. And as was his habit on the Sabbath, he went to the synagogue and there he stood up to read the Isaiah scroll. He read, he sat back, he gave the scroll back to the attendant, and with the eyes of the congregation fixed on him, he made initially a single statement, which was like a lightning bolt. He said, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." And all the people were pleased with this. And Jesus could have stopped right there, and everyone would have had a peaceful morning, and they could all go out to brunch. But Jesus did not stop there. Instead, he's like the boy who comes upon a beehive and looks around for a branch to see what will happen if he gives it a swing. And that's what he did in about 40 seconds and 100 words. The mood changed dramatically. We're going to come back to the details of the dialogue in just a minute, but you can see that the crowd was completely changed. In fact, in their fury, they decided to kill him by throwing him off a cliff. But we read, Jesus walked right through the crowd and went on his way. And in my sanctified imagination, he does this as coolly as James Bond straightening his cufflinks after an assassination attempt. And the synagogue became the site of a most memorable worship service. So what could possibly have gone so wrong? What went so awry? There are mysteries here to be plumbed, and we're going to do that in just a moment, but I'd like to stop first and tell you something about what this passage has meant to this old guy personally over a period of years. So over my Christian life, I've returned to this passage over and over, always seeing new things. There is an analogy that I'd like to talk about from the world of art as to what this passage has meant to me. One of my favorite artists is the French impressionist Claude Monet. Monet painted outdoor scenes, and he worked quickly to capture the light as the day went on. Sometimes he would work on as many as 14 canvases in a given day. So you're looking at a series that he did called The Haystacks, in which Monet portrayed the simultaneous simplicity and complexity of the humble haystack. So this passage of Luke 4 to me bears a similarity to the Monet haystacks. As I've read this passage, I've seen different truths in different time periods. I think the truths were always there, but I was not able to understand them until I'd gotten to a certain level of life experience and study. So I'd like to tell you something about what this passage has meant to me progressively over years and what it means to me now. So this is my early morning haystack. I grew up in a non-Christian home. I was ignorant of the faith, and When I was about 20 years old, I heard the gospel for the first time, and I made a profession of faith. And from the very beginning, as I saw how Christians thought about things and conducted their lives, and I compared them with their non-Christian counterparts, I understood that Jesus was the dividing point of humanity. I was also going to university classes on the New Testament. They were taught from a skeptical and secular point of view, but far from bringing me into doubt, my reaction was to affirm the necessity of Scripture as my guide for faith and practice. So as I read Luke 4, in my early Christian life, I understood that Jesus was the dividing point of humanity and that Scripture was his guide and should be my guide. This is my mid-morning haystack. I became a Christian outside of the church, and for some years, I held the church in low esteem. My wife, Susan, though, was hired by Central Presbyterian Church in St. Louis, an EPC church, and we came to love the church. So at this phase of my life, as I read Luke 4, I would have seen the beauty of the synagogue for the first time. Here's my early afternoon haystack. After a few years in the church, I encountered a God that was so much bigger than the God I had known previously, and I encountered that God through Reformed theology. So in Luke 4, I saw first God's sovereignty over salvation. I saw the essential unity of the Old Testament and the New Testament, and to my chagrin, I observed the failure of Israel. So let me talk about that for just a minute. Here is the big picture of Scripture. On the left side, creation. This is familiar to so many of you. Creation, fall, redemption, the work of Christ, and consummation. That's the arc of redemption history. And I understood that as people who are redeemed from the call, from the fall, the call on believers is to join with God to display what the kingdom of God will look like when that kingdom is fully realized at the return of Christ. And it is my responsibility to join with that progress and to call others, to invite other people to join the redeemed. We are, in effect, the preview for the movie, the trailer for the movie that makes people want to join and come, right? But as we'll see in Luke 4, Israel failed to put God's character on display, and that saddened and disappointed me. So here is my low sun haystack. It's beautiful, isn't it? Could have been yours for a mere $110 million a few years ago. I've visited this passage again for reasons that were related to my own personal situation, to my church, and to my community. So I retired from the practice of law and needed guidance for my next phase of life. Second, for my own church, we were a church plant and we'd worshipped in schools for many years, and we found a permanent location, and so we needed to reassess our mission and vision. And third, I was concerned about my community. 5 years ago this summer, an unarmed African-American teenager named Michael Brown was killed in Ferguson, Missouri, by a white police officer, and the community around me erupted. I, as would be typical of a white male and a lawyer, you know what I did. I read the grand jury report, and I could not understand the anger. And I realized that I knew too little of the causes of the anger, and that I had never done too much of anything ever to address race and ethnicity, which I think is the most difficult problem for my community and for our nation. And so I felt called to better understand the community around me and to see what the Bible has to say about race and ethnicity. So these combined factors caused me to look at this morning's passage with new eyes. So there are certain mysteries about this passage. Let's address a few of those. So We'll start with the basics. Question one, why did Jesus read this particular passage in the synagogue of Nazareth? And the short answer is, we don't know. There are some people who think that there was a regular lectionary, and this passage was on the schedule. It just happened to be on the schedule for this day's. Some people think that the attendant picked the passage. Some people think that Jesus picked the passage. Question two, why did Jesus sit down and then speak? We're used to the pastor or the speaker coming up to a lectionary, speaking, and then sitting down. And that's our picture for what happened here, and it seems a little odd. But the custom in the synagogue was different. That is, the rabbi sat down to deliver the message. So when Jesus sat down, he spoke in the customary rabbinical position. The number three question, what was in the reading? Jesus read 2.5 verses from Isaiah 61, half a verse from Isaiah 58, and the last words, the year of the Lord's favor, refers to Leviticus 25. So let's talk about what he had to say. So the passage starts off with these words. The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me. Just so we haven't missed it. When Jesus first comes in, we're told that he is ministering in the power of the Holy Spirit. And now we're saying again that the speaker is speaking in the power of the Holy Spirit, and he is doing that as the anointed, the Christ, the Messiah of God. So when Jesus said, today this is fulfilled in your hearing, he was saying two things. He was claiming to be the Messiah, and he was going to go on to proclaim the mission of the Messiah. So let's talk about the mission, the words that followed. The Messiah, Isaiah said, when he comes, will do five things. He will proclaim good news to the poor. He will set prisoners free. He will give sight to the blind. He will set the oppressed free. And he will proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. I want us to see here that there is a mix of proclamation and action, of word and deed. Let's look at the verbs that are used. So the first one is proclaim. The second one is set free. The third is give sight. The fourth is set free. And the fifth is proclaim. If we want to go through those, we can pair them. So number one is proclaim. Number five is proclaim. There is a ministry of proclamation that is undertaken by the Messiah. Number two and number four, set free, right? There is a ministry here of justice. And number three, right in the middle of the sandwich, the middle of the chiasm, is give sight. There is a ministry of compassion, word and deed. Now that last one, proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. That deserves some additional attention. So let's talk about that. That is from Leviticus 25, and the year of the Lord's favor was also called there the year of Jubilee. Every 50 years, the law said, was to be a year of Jubilee during which four things were to happen. Families were to return home. Land was returned to the original owners. Debts were to be forgiven, and slaves were to be freed. Now, I think we need to stop here for a minute, because for some of you, your eyes are glazing over and you're thinking, what is all this Old Testament stuff, and why are we going through this? So here is going to be our point. As I've read through this and reflected on this passage, I realize that the ministry of Jesus is much broader than I have been thinking it to be, right? This is a very broad ministry. So when we look at those four things, doesn't that look like a foreshadowing of heaven? First of all, families to return home. There will come a day when we are no longer strangers, when we are no longer aliens, we return home. And we will be families in a way that is only glimpsed by us in our imperfect world. We will be truly brothers and sisters. Secondly, land returned to the original owners. God will give us a land that he has for us that we can't even imagine. We will no longer be barred from his presence as we were and have been since Eden. Debts forgiven. Well, that's easy, right? Our sins are forgiven. And slaves freed. Our natures will be changed. We will no longer be addicted. We will no longer have habits that we can't change. We will be freed from our sinful nature. So Israel had the opportunity to present a glimpse of what heaven was to be like. Every 50 years, things start over, and we can see in a real model what the end times will be like. And yet, I'm sorry to tell you that as we read the history books of Israel, there is no place where we see that this was actually ever carried out. And that saddened me. But the Jews held on to the Jubilee, the year of the Lord's favor, through Isaiah's prophecy. They understood that when the prophet came, when the Messiah came, he would carry out this mission. And now that Messiah was before the people of Nazareth, and he invited them to join him in his mission. And how did the people of Nazareth respond? They thought it was nice. They liked his elocution. Oh, I thought he spoke so well, didn't you? So question four, question five. Things went badly awry. So what got into the people of Nazareth? And what got into Jesus? Why were the people of Nazareth so crazy volatile? Let's start with that. And my proposed answer is that the Nazareth pharmacy had not received that week's shipment of antidepressants, and everybody was very grouchy. What got into Jesus? Well, he wasn't very good with people, was he? I think he'd left Nazareth charm school to attend carpentry tech, and he'd done it too early. So let's talk for a minute more seriously about the people of Nazareth. Jesus saw into the hearts of the people of Nazareth, and he called them on it. Recall that Jesus, we're told, twice is speaking in the power of the Spirit. There are at least seven times in the Gospels where we are told that Jesus sees into the hearts of humankind. And surely Jesus saw into the hearts of the people of Nazareth here. So what Jesus does here, I would not advise you to use to try at home unless you are very sure of the power of the Spirit in your life. Jesus wanted to see a radical faith, and he was asking, would the people of Nazareth follow him? And the answer is, not so far. There's nobody packing up their bags to go with Jesus to see this mission fulfilled. So Jesus, as he speaks next, is speaking by the thoughts and attitudes of the people of Nazareth. And Jesus first saw unbelief. So he says to them, doubtless you will say to me, physician, heal yourself. What we have heard you did at Capernaum, do here in your hometown as well. So the people of Nazareth wanted Jesus to show his stuff and to do it for their benefit. He first said, physician, heal yourself. That's an expression that would be along the lines of, take care of you and yours first. They wanted Jesus to focus on his hometown. And they were also thinking, now this is an interesting way of wording it, what we have heard you did at Capernaum, do here. They want to see it for themselves. They didn't say what you did at Capernaum. They want to see for themselves, and they wanted it to be for their benefit. They still wanted Jesus to prove himself. And if you've been healing someplace else, Jesus, over at Capernaum, we want to see some of that here. Have you been casting out evil spirits? Do that for us. They did not want to join Jesus' mission. What they wanted was for Jesus to join their mission. Now, the second thing that Jesus saw in them was pride, and it was not the good kind of pride. This is unfounded pride, the kind of pride that does not rely on God's grace but on our own merits. The people of Nazareth apparently believed themselves to be superior because they were Jewish, in God's favor because they were Jewish, and perhaps even owed salvation because they were Jewish. And this is why Jesus reminded them of two Gentiles who had experienced God's favor. So first, Jesus reminded them of the story of the prophet Elijah, which we heard about from Lance the other night. Elijah fled Israel to avoid the famine and came to the town of Zarephath, and there he performed a miracle to feed a Gentile woman and her son, and not to take care of the widows of Israel. Jesus also reminded them of the story of the prophet Elisha, who healed Naaman the Syrian, a Syrian military leader who had leprosy, and he used the power of God to heal a Gentile in preference to the lepers of Israel. And at that, the synagogue of Nazareth went pow! Now, the people of Israel, the people of Nazareth, could at that point have joined the disciples in joy. They could have gone with Jesus to fulfill this fabulous mission, but they did not. They could not believe that Jesus was suggesting that God would reach outside the circle of Jews to include people of other ethnic groups. Jesus walked away, and so far as we know, he never returned to Nazareth. Well, I said earlier that this passage has spoken to me in different ways at different times in my life, and that I was looking at this passage through my present lens, which was questions about my own personal life, about my own church, and my community. So I'd like to tell you about a couple of conversations that Susan and I have had as we have visited church plants this year on behalf of the EPC. And I'd like to perhaps challenge us as leaders in our churches and in our denominations. First, we saw earlier from Isaiah 61 and Isaiah 58 and Leviticus 20-25 that the mission of Jesus is for the whole person. It's a broader mission that I've thought was the mission of my faith. We had a number of interesting conversations with church planters, but one of the more interesting conversations we had was over dinner with a couple who are planning a church on the north side of downtown Memphis. And as our dinner progressed, I would say that we went from what I think started off as a sort of a formal stiffness. We warmed to each other. We discovered we had things in common. As the dinner went on, I talked about the work and hopes for Revelation 7-9 Task Force. And after a while, the wife said to me, somewhat shyly, said to Susan and me, that her great-great-grandmother was an enslaved woman, a woman named Frances Wiggins. And she had been sold on the public auction block just a few blocks away from our restaurant. And we could talk about that. Susan and I were asking her questions. She was helping us understand what that feels like. That's an experience I know nothing about. Do you think I could understand Ferguson if I don't understand that? That is a whole person conversation. And it's one that we need to have in the EPC. We should be ministering to each other as whole people. Second, the mission of Jesus is for the whole world. Gentiles and Jews, majority culture, minority culture, across gender lines, all across every kind of line. It's for the whole world. We, I think, accept this challenge eagerly in world missions, but I think it also applies in our neighborhoods. This draws attention to people who are not typically in our churches. Again, Susan and I went to church plants in upstate New York. This is an area about 45 minutes from Woodstock, which kind of gives you an idea of what the predominant worldview is there. This has been post-Christian for a long time, more than a generation. A single mom visited an EPC church plant that we have up there, and she loved it. She felt the warmth of the congregation to her and to her children, and she attended for some while, but she had a personal question for the pastor. She was in a same-sex relationship. Would she be accepted? And our church planting pastor told her that she mattered to God, she mattered to the church, and she would be welcome as long as she wished to attend. And he furnished her with the EPC position paper on human sexuality. And she wrote him an email that said the position paper had disheartened her. And for some while, she stopped attending. Then after some months, she returned to our EPC church and said that the EPC church plant was a safe place, a welcoming place, a caring place, and that she'd missed it while she was away. Now, these are only two stories, right? It's hard to draw generalities from that. But I think the EPC can be characterized as a denomination in which we want to minister to the whole person, and in which we want to minister to the whole world. The story of Jesus in the synagogue in Nazareth ends as a cautionary tale, doesn't it? Jesus leaves his hometown after they try to kill him, and he never returns. I think the story here for us is about the mission of Jesus, about how wide and how deep it is, much wider and deeper than I've thought it to be. I want to make it clear that the EPC is not the Nazareth synagogue. Their story has been written. Ours is still in the writing. What will our story look like? I'm hopeful. I'm very encouraged by what I see in the EPC. As I've looked over the last year at church plants and participated in Revelation 7:9, this is where I believe we're headed. I think we're submitted to God. I think we're reformed and reforming. I think we're evangelical in our outreach. But broadening our mission and our outreach will not be easy. And that brings me to the third challenge. The mission of Jesus requires radical faith, selfless faith. That was the problem of the synagogue of Nazareth. They were mostly concerned with their own situation. The easy path is to stay where we are and ask Jesus to bless what we are doing. The hard path is to join him and his mission. The mission is high and wide and deep and for the whole world. Some of you may be feeling, I think, overwhelmed by this possibility. You're working flat out. It's hard. And I can't tell you what to do about that. I think it would be presumptuous of me. But I hope, if you're feeling overwhelmed, that God has you exactly where he wants you. Yield it to him, realizing this is beyond our own capacities. So, to change, to move on, to follow Jesus, perhaps we have to acknowledge that we are not inclined to break out of our own habits. We're going to have to ask him to be present with us. We're going to have to rely on the Holy Spirit. We're going to have to use all the giftedness that we have and that is available in our congregations. We may have to drop some things that we're doing now and that are perhaps popular in order to follow Jesus fully. And you may need brothers and sisters to pray for you, and fortunately they are available to you this morning. I would ask that when our story is written, may it be said of us that we followed the mission of Jesus. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this cautionary tale of Jesus in the Nazareth synagogue. Help us to know that your mission, in all its breadth and width and depth, help us as people, your people, to actually follow your mission in radical faith, selflessly, and to follow nothing else. Help us to minister in your spirit and with your presence. Amen.